I'd like to welcome you to our second webinar about the St. John Passion and wish you all a happy Telemann's birthday. At this point, I'd like to introduce Michael Marissen, who's one of the foremost Bach scholars in the world and has published a lot of articles about Bach and religion, both for general audiences and for specialists. You may have read his articles in the New York Times or the Huffington Post, or if you're a Lutheran, in the Lutheran Forum. He's also published a lot of work in journals and books for specialists. He is Professor Emeritus of Music at Swarthmore College, and he's retired now from there, and currently preparing a heavily annotated translation of all 225 Bach cantata librettos with Daniel Melamed. And I just want to ask, Michael, where was this 25 years ago when it would have been so lovely to have? It's really filling a gap in, well, there are translations of Bach cantatas, but it will be interesting to have Michael and Daniel's translation with a lot of annotations, very useful for performers and for people who love Bach. His lecture is entitled The Musical Aims of Bach's St. John Passion. At this point, I'm going to turn it over to him. Oh, one more thing. If you think of a question, you can enter it in the Q&A feature. Don't use the chat, use the Q&A for questions. And at the end, we'll also have a live Q&A, and you can use the raise hand feature to get our attention, and we can call on you and you can ask it live. Thanks very much.
Okay, great. Thank you, Jane. This sounds, you can hear me fine. So this technology is very confusing all the time. I'm going to share a screen, and my intention is to play a series of music examples and illustrate certain aspects of the text in Bach's setting of the St. John Passion. Okay, so maybe where I'd like to start is that, or what is the St. John Passion exactly? It is Bach's setting of verbatim of the entire Passion narrative in the Gospel of John, and that is sung as sort of heightened speech by a tenor soloist who chants the entire story. And whenever there is more than one person in the story who's speaking, then sometimes a duet or a trio or a chorus will sing the words of multiple characters. But that's one sort of layer of the thing textually and musically. And it's very clearly distinguished from the other kinds of texts and other kinds of music that appear in the work. If it were just a musical setting of the Passion narrative, it would probably only be about 20 minutes long. Or half an hour maybe, but it's much longer than that because of all the extra poetry that comments on it and the extra music that goes with that. And so basically what happens is that after every couple of verses of the biblical narrative, it will break off into a kind of meditation or commentary. And those basically take two kinds of forms. One, they can be, if the biblical text is Martin Luther's idiosyncratic translation from the 16th century into German of the Greek New Testament text, then one of the kinds of commentary that will appear will be a very carefully chosen hymn stanza from the Lutheran repertory that may have been written in the 16th or 17th or even 18th century. So that's a very slow moving, beautiful, totally different kind of music. There's no confusion about where you are and things. You'll know that that's something different's going on there. So that's one kind of way that you can comment or meditate on the story. Another way is to write new modern 18th century rhyming accented poetry and set it for soloists accompanied by an orchestra such that the orchestra plays a kind of instrumental refrain that appears in between each of the verbal utterances by the singers, which are called episodes. And that's the kind of music that's usually everyone's favorite. And if you buy a greatest hits CD of Bach and it has any Passion music on it at all, it might have one or two hymns in it. Even that's unlikely. It's very unlikely to have any of the recitation of the biblical story. And it's very likely to have some of these arias. And so what I want to do is give you some sense of how Bach comments on the biblical narrative and how his musical setting sometimes goes beyond simply finding the emotional content of the poetry and, as it were, translating that into music. But sometimes it even kind of had this sort of what's called what literary theorists like to call a hermeneutic plus, where the music sometimes can put a spin on the text in a way that makes it mean more than it would if you just read it as poetry. It's probably always going to be more powerful than it would have been just as poetry, simply because of the depth of the emotional power of the music. But it can be very interesting when the music itself, so to speak, is also interpretive or religious in nature. So I give you some sort of sense of what the different kinds of things are that happen in the work. The one thing I didn't say yet is that it's fairly standard in Bach's day to frame all of that, what I've described already, with a huge opening chorus and a huge closing chorus that literally frame the entire piece and act sort of like the sonic equivalent of a big fancy frame on a painting. So the way I wanted to start then was by playing you the way things, when musical settings of the Passion were made in Latin in the Renaissance and the medieval period, they typically just set the entire biblical text in Latin and then had a framing opening chorus and closing chorus, and that was it. And the opening framing chorus, what it typically did was just said in Latin, the Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to the Gospel of John, as you see on the text that's in the middle of your screen there. And if you're using an iPad or a phone, you might want to pinch that part. You don't need to see the left side music screen there. The text thing will always be on the right, and you can make that bigger if you like. So here I'm going to play in rapid succession then. First, a medieval choir singing what it sounds like for them to sing the opening frame of a setting of the Passion narratives of music, and then segue directly to those very same words in Latin sung in, during the Renaissance. And you can tell it's a totally different style of music, but both of them are just basically beautiful and informational. There doesn't seem to be much more to it than that. Here's the Gregorian chant version of it. And I think you can hear right away when you hear the opening framing chorus of the Bach St. John Passion, you're in a totally different world. Let me play the first minute or so of the opening chorus of the standard version of the Bach St. John Passion. Thank you. So that's an amazing thing. We could easily spend our entire hour together this afternoon just talking about this opening chorus. And it's my daughter studied film theory in college, and she always said that in a great art film, the main themes of an art film are laid out to you, whether you realize it or not, in the first 30 seconds or so of the film. And that's true for these large scale masterpieces like the John Passion too. This is setting what Bach's version of the John story is going to be about. And it's impossible to capture in English what is actually built already into the text of this thing, where you could see the blue squares around the words Herr, Herrscher, Herrlich, Verherrlicht. The idea here is that the Lord, the Herr, is a ruler, a Herrscher, who's glorious, Herrlich, and he's been glorified, Verherrlicht, in a particular very strong or aspect of a traditional Christianity that Luther really picked up on, the idea that through humiliation and abasement, that's where the glory of God would be revealed. And this makes this is sort of convoluted metaphor, but the idea was that what Luther said in his own writings on this was that just as when Moses went up on the mountain to receive the law to bring to the people from God, God's glory was so powerful that Moses was only able to see the glory of God, as it were, from the backside. Because if you saw the glory of God straight on, you would die from the sheer power of the glory. And Luther's view was that when Jesus dies on the cross, the humiliation and denigration of that is the metaphorical backside of God. And when you, as a follower of Jesus, contemplate the passion, you are seeing the backside of God, the glory of God. It's a brilliant sort of interpretation of what seems to be a horrible event. The death of Jesus on the cross is in fact not his lowest moment, but his highest moment. That's central to the Gospel of John and to Luther's interpretation of it. And what also is sort of amazing about this chorus is that what the orchestra plays, even before the, you may have noticed that when you hear the concert next week, listen for this, that ordinarily in Bach works, what the orchestra plays, its refrain before the ensemble singers come in, it usually ends up on a strong beat in the metric pattern on the home pitch of the piece, and then the singers come in. But this one has the harmonic tension and the resolution of that go directly into the singing. So the first resolution of the opening is right on the word Herr, and they scream out the words Herr three times in a row, the idea being Lord God the Father, Lord God the Son, Lord God the Holy Spirit, show us that this Trinitarian God has been glorified in the crucifixion, is the idea. And I thought it'd be interesting for you to see the following very famous painting by Cranach the Elder. This painting was on the altar in the Nikolai Church in Leipzig, where the St. John Passion was first performed. And there's a visual component, the visual aspects of this painting are realized sonically already in what the orchestra plays before the chorus comes in and screams out its words, Herr, three times in a row. Here you see a picture of God the Father with the tiara on there, holding the Jesus just fresh off the cross. If you look really closely, you can still see the holes in his hands and everything. And then on his knee is perched a dove that represents the Holy Spirit. So this is a famous Trinity painting. And that Trinitarian idea is built already into what the orchestra plays before the chorus comes in, because the bottom voice is going boom, 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 boom. That's the so-called fundamentum in the Baroque texture. That's the sort of sonic representation of God the Father, the foundation of the Trinity. And the swirling around strings represent the Holy Spirit, the dove there, and the flutes and oboes with their constant dissonance and consonance, sort of twisting and turning in agony. That's a depiction of the of divine and human Jesus being crucified, is the idea. So the basic idea of the St. John Passion is all spelled out in that opening chorus, and then the rest of the setting is just fleshing that, no pun intended, fleshing that all out. Now, Bach performed a musical setting of the John Passion many times during his decades in Leipzig, and the first time was in 1724. And that was the chorus that you just heard. But in 1725, in his second year in Leipzig, he was going to do a Matthew Passion and decided to do a John again at the last minute. And he restructured it somewhat by giving it a totally new framing opening chorus and a totally new closing chorus, and substituted some of the commentary arias in the middle of the piece. And here the emphasis is much, much different. Here is the text of the opening chorus of the St. John Passion in 1725. And here I can think you can hear right away, it sounds totally different from the chorus that we've just been talking about. Here's just the opening of it, the music to it. So that's a totally different. That's confounded technology. Okay, bear with me a second. Sorry. This is a totally different approach to the John Passion narrative, where the other one is this cosmic Jesus with a very scary Trinitarian, terrifying kind of orchestral music. This is a totally different Baroque style, where you slur notes together in such a way. That was called the technical term for that in opera in the 18th century was a fettuoso sort of writing. So the orchestra already is consoling you even before the text comes in. And when the text does come in, it's not talking about who Jesus is and how he fits into his divinity and humanity and so on. It's the first line of it is, "Oh, humankind, bewail your sin." Sin is right there in the first line of the thing. And sin is not a big element in the Gospel of John itself. The big sin in the Gospel of John is not to believe that Jesus is God's Messiah. But other than that, it doesn't talk that much about other kinds of sin. And so the idea that is in the 1725 version of the St. John Passion, there's a much greater focus all the way through in the opening and closing chorus and in the other meditating things on more on sin than there was in the scarier, more traditional setting. The other thing that Bach's original audiences would have found very consoling and comforting about this framing chorus in the second version of the St. John Passion is that what the sopranos were singing in slow-mo there, some of you may have recognized it already because Bach later used this same chorus as the closing for part one of the Matthew Passion, but in a different key, a little higher. Not only would they have found the orchestra very comforting because of its effettuoso writing and so on, but the text and melody was already extremely familiar to them because this is a famous Lutheran hymn, "O Mensch, bewein dein Sünde groß." And so I'll play just the first 10 seconds or so of what the hymn sounds like when you extract it from that massive effettuoso texture that we were just listening to. Here's the hymn just by itself. Very beautiful, very straightforward, not a particularly big deal musically, but that's exactly that text and that melody is what gets dressed up into that fabulous opening chorus of the 1725 version of the Matthew Passion. So just to quickly review without seeming too elementary schoolish about it. Now let me play again just the first 5 seconds, no text, just orchestral music, just the first 5 or 10 seconds of the 1724 version of the St. John Passion, followed immediately by the 1725 version. And you can tell just in a few seconds that you're in a totally different world. Here's the original. Here's the other. And here's the other. Sorry, it's very confusing. With this music sound, it's just amazing how your eyes can sort of space out when you're looking at all this text here. So here's the more consoling one. Now, if the opening is very, very different, also the closing of the two versions is very, very different. And the reason I keep harping on the other version is because the 1725 version hardly ever gets performed. And I think that it'll be interesting for folks to hear the standard version sort of in light of the other one. The contrast sort of brings the original even into stronger relief is the idea. So if the standard version of the piece started in this very sort of grim way, it ends in a very sanguine, upbeat, beautiful way with the following stanza from a hymn, Ach Herr, lass dein Lieb Engelein. Extremely beautiful, beautiful way to end the piece. You can leave the performance very peacefully. It's just a wonderful way to close the original version of the work. And that then sounds like this. But, my goodness, compare this with the closing of the 1725 version. Those of you who know the standard version quite well, you remember that what was happened right before that beautiful hymn that I just played was a very, very long chorus, Ruht wohl. That very, very long chorus, Ruht wohl, is used again in the 1725 version, and then is followed by another huge chorus, this one, Christe, du Lamm Gottes, which is another setting, the text that's in front of you and the melody sung by the soprano is a standard Lutheran hymn, but it's been dressed up into this unbelievably tragic sounding thing. And boy, as I don't know that whether in any of Bach's music that Jesus, the Lamb of God, has been implored so sadly to have mercy on people and the idea now again is that just as the opening chorus focused on sin, the closing chorus of the 1725 version very much focuses on sin, but is not sanguine in the way that it ends at all. That sounds then like this. I know some of you are involved in literary studies and so on. This, to me, sounds very much like the equivalent of that very, very difficult book by Walter Benjamin on the origin of German tragic drama, when he talks about how what the Trauerspiel, a particular kind of play in the 17th century Germany, is basically, you know, the royal figure walking across the stage slowly as a sort of march towards death. That's what this thing sounds like to me. And actually, the opening chorus of the St. Matthew Passion sounds a little bit like that as well. So we spent a lot of time now on the framing of the Passion narrative in two different ways by Bach for the John narrative. Now I want to sort of lighten up a little bit and focus in on the way that Jesus is depicted and the way that Jesus himself sings in the biblical text, in the biblical portion of the story, because there's some very, even the smallest musical detail in Bach can have a tremendous interpretive significance. The example that I want to give is of at the beginning of the narrative, when attendants of the chief priests and temple police and so on are going out to seize Jesus in the garden. And unlike in the other canonical gospels, where Jesus is much more, the human side of Jesus seems to be much more emphasized than the divine side. There in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, Jesus is saying, do I really have to do this? Oh my God, God's betraying, God's forsaken me. Do I really have to drink this cup, and so on and so forth? But in the Gospel of John, when people come out looking for him, he actually steps out and says, who are you looking for? And the large gathering, according to the Gospel of John, it's a cohort. It includes a cohort of Roman soldiers. So 600 Roman soldiers, along with the others, say, answer him, we're looking for Jesus of Nazareth. And then Jesus' response is, ich bin's, in German. And I've put the that I am in capital letters here, because the idea is that in the gospel, it's the very next line of the thing says that as soon as Jesus says, I am, the entire cohort, everyone in the garden there, falls involuntarily to the ground. It's a little story detail that passes by a lot of people. It's something that Bach was very attentive to, I'm about to suggest to you then, because the idea here is that the words, the underlying Greek words of the that I am or ich bin's here is ego eimi. And in the so-called absolute usage of the words ego eimi, those words in Greek were used to translate what it is that God is depicted as saying to Moses from a burning bush that isn't consumed by the fire when he's trying to get him to go get the Israelites out of slavery in Egypt. Moses says, and who is it that I'm talking to? And the bush says back to him, I am that I am, sort of the divine name, so to speak. And so the idea here is that when Jesus says, ich bin's, he's not just saying, like in colloquial German, if someone knocks on your door, especially in New York City here, if someone knocks on your door, you never just open the door. You want to know who it is. And someone says on the other side, if they're German and they say, ich bin's, and you recognize their voice, then that's the non-absolute usage of the, but if it were Jesus actually standing on the other side of the door and he said, ich bin's, then you would fall involuntarily to the ground, because this is a theophany, a revelation of God in front of people. Now, what does this have to do with Bach? Bach sets each of these ich bin's statements to just two notes, the fifth note of the scale going to the first note of the scale, ich bin's. You think, big deal, that must be a standard move in Baroque music. But in fact, it's exceedingly rare. I don't know anyone else who did that. And that idea keeps coming back. And so what I'm going to do is play a bunch of 5-second examples in a row, where each time Jesus says ich bin's, it's to that melodic formula. And then when Peter is asked, the sort of main disciple of Jesus, aren't you one of Jesus' disciples? And he says, that I am not, ich bin's nicht. And when he sings ich bin's nicht, it's an extremely convoluted, ornamented version of the straight truth of what Jesus said. Of course, Peter can't, by definition, can't really say ich bin's, but it's very clear that the musical setting of the way that Peter denies Jesus is very closely related to it's a convoluted version of the true version that Jesus says in the first place. So here's the way Jesus responds the first time that he says ich bin's.
Jesus spricht zu ihnen.
Now, any other composer in the Baroque would have just used that idea just for when the words Ich bin's come up. But there's a couple of other places in the narrative where Bach uses that. So when Pilate, the governor of Judea, the Roman governor of Judea, is asking Jesus, he's constantly saying, who are you? And he never gives a straight answer to anything. That's the way Jesus behaves in the Gospel of John. And so after interrogating him for a while, he says, are you the king of the Jews? Jesus answers, do you say that on your own, or do others have others of that said it to you about me? Listen very carefully to the way Jesus sings this in Bach when he says, redest du das. The redest du is to the exact same formula as the ego eimi. So that is to say, what Bach's musical setting is doing here is the text is saying, redest du, but the music is saying, ich bin's. It's saying, yes, I am. Yes is the answer. So that sounds like this.
Bist du der Juden König? Jesus antwortete, redest du das von dir selbst? Oder haben dir
I mean, it sneaks by really, really quickly, but for those who are really paying attention, that's sort of an extra thing to pick up on. Maybe this is the point at which I'd also say that one of the great things about composers like Bach and Mozart and a few other people is that they're extremely good at writing music that can appeal to extremely sophisticated listeners, to moderate listeners, and to casual listeners. And for all levels, there's really something for them. There's enough for them there to be very satisfying. But if you're more advanced, you might pick up on you might find it satisfying to pick up on smaller details like this. Okay, so then later in the narrative, Pilate says, so you are a king then? And Jesus answers, you are saying so. And this too, du sagst, is also set to the absolute ego eimi formula. And that sounds like this.
So bist du denn noch ein König? Jesus antwortete, du sagst, ich bin ein
So now in rapid succession, I'll do a repeat of Jesus saying Ich bin's at the first, and then right after that have Peter denying him twice. And if you hear them right after each other, then it's much clearer without the 10 minutes in between that the one is a convoluted version of the other. So that's what the first that I am not is should sound like to you. And then the second that I am not is the same harmonic formula and the same melodic formula, but now it's higher than it was the first time. So it's an intensified lying or denial, even though the rhythm and the harmonies and the melody are the same, because it's at a higher pitch level, you experience it as an intensification of the disavowal. And that then sounds like this.
Jesus spricht zu ihnen.
So that should make it clear that Bach isn't solely focused on the modern part of the musical setting and doesn't really care about the biblical text and is just trying to get it over with as soon as possible so he can get to the parts that everyone wants to find on their greatest hits CDs. He's paying very close attention to very special aspects of the biblical story itself. Now, just for a minute or so, less comfortably, we had a whole panel on this last week, so I don't want to spend too much time on it now. But since one of my research specialties has been religious polemic in the Baroque period, so anti-Jewish and anti-Catholic and anti-Muslim sentiments in the music of Bach and others. People, of course, want to know what do you really think of the St. Matthew Passion and the John Passion and so on and so forth. And I say, well, the one generalization I can make is that the commentary on the challenge with the Gospel of John is that it's constantly harping on the Jews as Jesus and God's enemies, and the greatest sinners because they don't believe that Jesus is God's Messiah. And in John 8, the story has Jesus saying to the Jews, you are liars and killers by nature and volition. And then in John 16, it says that you followers of Jesus who believe that Jesus is God's Messiah, you will be excommunicated from the synagogue. But a time is coming soon when they, the Jews, will kill you and think that God is doing, I think that they're doing God a service in doing so. And so that background, the Lutherans in Bach, they knew the Gospel of John chapter 8 and 16 because they had been preached upon just right around the time that the Passion comes up in the liturgy. And so they would understand that the Passion narrative could be understood as a working out of the lying and the lying violent Jews are doing what is sort of essentially predicted earlier in the Gospel. So what does this have to do with Bach then? A lot of composers in Bach's day, when it comes to the commenting on the Passion narrative, particularly in John, they will sort of pour some gasoline on the embers there and say, yeah, what do you expect from Jews and so on and so forth. Bach's commentary does not focus on that at all. It's very focused on Christian sin and Christian responsibility for the Lutheran belief was that even people living now in 2021 are logically responsible for the death of Jesus 2000 years ago. So if most people find that good news nowadays, so the idea is that the interpretive side of the commentary or meditation on the Passion narrative in John is much less polemical than most other composers from his own time. That's the good news. The bad news, however, is that in his setting of the biblical narrative, he's much more ferocious in the way that he depicts the Jews in the Gospel of John, both in the church cantatas where John 8 and 16 come up, or in the John Passion itself that we're talking about now. And to give a really striking idea of that, what I wanted to do was play for you a sort of standard setting from the Baroque period by a very famous opera composer named Kaiser, how the chorus, when it sings Crucify Jesus, it's not pleasant, but it's brief and it gets the information across forcefully but quickly. When Bach sets a Crucify hymn, instead of just saying it four times like the Kaiser thing, he says it 34 times. It really seems, if you'll forgive the expression, it seems a little bit like overkill. Many people find it extremely exhilarating aesthetically, and that raises some extremely interesting ethical questions too. If one finds very aesthetically satisfying what is essentially a dramatizing of a kind of bloodlust. But now if we play these right next to each other, you'll see how very much more ferocious Bach actually is than his typical contemporaries. Here's the Kaiser setting of John 19, verse 6.
In die hohen Priester und die Diener sahen, schrien sie und sprachen, Kreuzige, Kreuzige!
And this is Bach.
Und er spricht zu den Jüden, Seht, das ist euer König. Sie schrien aber,
Oh, Okay. Well, so I want to spend just a few minutes, try to wrap it up in 10 minutes or so yet, and then leave time for some comments and questions and so on. If you really want to see what someone's attitude is towards Judaism in the John, in any John passion from the 18th century, the one of the striking places to do that is the place in the narrative which Jesus is brought before the Sanhedrin before being brought before Pilate. And one of the attendants of the high priest there gets very frustrated with Jesus not answering questions straightforwardly and so on, and gets sort of fed up and punches Jesus in the face and says, you know, should you talk to the high priest like that? And Jesus answers, well, if I've spoken badly, then prove that it's evil. But if I've spoken rightly, why do you strike me? And then Handel and Telemann, who's Telemann's a wonderful composer whose birthday is right now, they will say things like that, or what do you expect from the sacrilegious hand of the violent lying Jew, and so on and so forth. But it's very interesting how Bach responds here. It's a very, very beautiful stanza from a hymn in which the words, I, and my sins, which are as countless as the grains of sand on the seashore, they have caused you this sorrow. And that's powerful enough in itself, and I'll play you that in just a second. But what's really amazing is in the 1725 version that I was talking about earlier, Bach seems to have thought that, hey, that's not enough. Let's add a whole nother movement right at this point. So he has the choir sing this hymn that I'm about to play for you. And then he inserts another, a modern aria into which that modern poetry, a hymn has been grafted into that as well. And that's a spectacular sort of last example that I'm going to want to play for you from the John Passion to show the, if Bach's really intense on the biblical side, he's the biblical narrative side, he's also extremely intense on the commentary side. And here then is what that hymn sounds like responding to the Jesus being struck in the face by the attendant. Now, one potential problem, even with that, though, is that many of sort of my aesthete friends have said, well, you know, well, you can get around all these problems. Who cares about the content of these, the verbal content of these things? Just listen to the beautiful music or the dramatic music and so on and so forth. I said, well, that, you know, maybe that'll work in certain contexts. But it doesn't particularly work well in the Bach St. John Passion because if you do that, you come away with a very strong sense that there are two kinds of choir music in this piece, essentially. Some that's very fast moving and violent, and others that's very slow and peaceful. And so even if you have no idea what the text is about, you sort of subliminally come away with the idea that, oh, well, the quiet stuff, that's the Christians, and the violent stuff, that's the Jews. And that's not completely untrue, but it's much more nuanced and subtle than that. And so if you are paying attention to what the text is about, you will see that Christians are in fact, reprimanded as well in Bach's version of the John Passion, not just Jews. Okay, so that was the initial response to the slapping of Jesus across the face by the Jews. And then in the 1725 version, Bach wants to have a second hymn in there. And here's just the first line of that hymn, Jesu Deine Passion. Okay, And I'm going to play it twice more for you, because what I want you to be is, if you don't know this hymn already, there's a good chance that you don't. You can put that first line of text and the musical sound of it into short-term memory, it will very much enhance the unbelievable aria that is supplementally added right after that previous hymn that we played about I and my sins in the 1725 version. This is one of the most extraordinary movements in Bach's vocal music. And it's a pity that you hardly ever get to hear it, because it's in this other version of the Passion that hardly anyone ever does. So what you're seeing, don't worry about all those colored arrows and so on in front of you, but the main idea here is that the text that's in bold face, that's the hymn, Jesu Deine Passion, with the same words and the same melody that you just heard a little bit of. And then the regular Roman text, Heaven Tear Apart and so on, that is a bass soloist. And so what happens in this amazing movement is that you've got a very, very violent, emotionally upset, weeping, terrified bass singing something that would have been an amazing aria all by itself. And then out of nowhere, suddenly comes in the soprano singing the hymn in slow-mo. And it is all about joy and peace and wonderfulness and so on. So Bach found a way to combine complete opposites. Joy and sorrow are built right into each other in this piece in a way that Luther would have been extremely proud of. He's always saying things like that. And it's one thing to say them verbally, but to actually have an artwork in which you have something totally joyful and serene and surreal and so on the one hand, and something totally violent and emotional on the other, and they're intertwined in each other. And they're intertwined to such an extent, not just musically, but the poet who put this together, the stuff that's in regular text, if you look very carefully, you'll see that every alternate line in the aria text of this thing rhymes with the previous line in the hymn. So that means that not the verbal content, but the actual sort of the prosody of the two different kinds of poems are interlinked with each other, so that you cannot separate them from each other. And for the first couple of lines, in fact, while the bass is singing the word Leide, to suffer, the choir is singing the word Freude, which is supposed to rhyme with it. It's absolutely amazing thing. So that's the last example I'll play from the John Passion. Here then just is the opening line of the hymn again, to really lodge it into your short-term memory. Sounds like this. And again. Okay, check this out. Okay, and then finally, the last point I want to make is that people tend to think of the St. John Passion and the St. Matthew Passion and works like that as self-contained works, but in Bach's day, they certainly were just something that you heard on, or not just something, but they were a big something that you heard on Friday afternoon of Good Friday, and that wasn't the end of the story, and you were expected to come back on Sunday morning. And on Sunday morning, it was a totally different story. Jesus comes back from the death, and it's time for the Easter. And so now the last thing I want to play for you, just the first 30 seconds or so of Bach's Easter Oratorio. So you imagine that you've been away for a day and a half, and you come back, and this is what you hear. And what's amazing about the opening of the Easter Oratorio of Bach is that Bach's composition students and anyone who's sort of even half paying attention in the Nicholas Church or Thomas Church, I feel sure that they would have assumed that by the time the orchestra is finished playing altogether what sounds like it's going to be their instrumental refrain, it's time for the chorus to come in and start singing the words of the opening lines of the Easter Oratorio. But in fact, in this piece, when it's time for the choir to start singing, a subset of just the orchestra plays. And they do that for a little while. They play an episode just like a singer would have sung an episode. And then the whole orchestra comes back with its refrain right after that. So what this ends up being is that what I'd like to suggest to you is that the joy of Easter is so overwhelming that the beginning of the Easter Oratorio is in fact a wordless joy. Bach seems to not want even to have to, wants the joy to be so overwhelming that you don't want to be distracted even by words. So here's what, after you've heard several hours of the John Passion or the Matthew Passion, this is what you have to look forward to on Sunday morning. Amazing, here we go. Episode. Refrain. So you might have wondered, well, why don't they use trumpets and drums ever in the Passions thing? It was like semi against the law, actually, to say that's the stuff that you save for Easter is the idea. So I hope that you enjoy this as a sort of basic intro to certain aspects of the Bach's various settings of the John Passion. I'll certainly let Jane kick in at this point, though I already see that someone has posted a question about the various versions of the John. I'm glad to see that this is a topic of interest to people. But why don't you take it away as a moderator, Jane?
This is a question from David D. Why do you think Bach changed the framing and thus the emphasis for the second version and then changed back for subsequent versions?
Yeah, there's a lot of speculation about this. The standard sort of music history view is that the second version is designed to fit in with the whole series of cantatas, church cantatas that Bach wrote for his second year in Leipzig. And the vast majority of those church cantatas in Bach's second year in Leipzig were ones in which the sopranos sang a Lutheran hymn in slow-mo whilst the altos and tenors and basses swirl counterpoint around them to those words with orchestral refrains around those episodes. And so the idea was, since the standard version of the John Passion doesn't have an opening chorus that has a chorale like that, a hymn built into the texture, Bach decided to revise the John Passion and make it fit in with the rest of the cycle. It's hard to, and that might be part of it, but my own sense is that it's just sort of what you call epiphenomenon. My sense is he probably wanted to revise the thing and make it a little bit more human and sin oriented. And since he's revising it anyway, he may as well make it fit in with what's been going on for the previous weeks. And then the tradition in Leipzig was to alternate gospels every fourth, or to do the Mark, Matthew, Luke, John And so every fifth year, you start the cycle over again. And so in several subsequent performances of the John Passion, he did do the 1725 version, the one that I was playing those alternate movements from. And then there's a lost version from the 1730s in which he took out all those revisions, made it back what it was in the first place. And also, I'm going to be too inside baseball here, but there's a couple of minor insertions of the Gospel of Matthew and Mark into the biblical narrative in the standard version of the St. John Passion. He took those out too. And so that version, unfortunately, doesn't survive, but there was like a hyper Johannine version of the John Passion from the 1730s. And my guess was that Bach thought it would be cool to have a really super Johannine version of the piece. But I think the religious authorities in Leipzig really wanted more of this sort of human aspect. That's why the interpolations from Matthew and Mark were there in the first place, even in the first version. And then in the 1740s, it basically has the same structure as it did the non-1725 version, but some of the text is, some of the aria commentary texts are modified just slightly and have slightly more up-to-date sort of German from the 1740s instead of the more old-fashioned German from the 1720s. So it's common in Bach studies to talk, say that there are five versions of the St. John Passion. I don't think that's really quite right. We don't really know about that one from the 73. What I think is that there are basically two different approaches to the Gospel of John, and there are three slight variants of the one. That's the one that everyone does. In fact, many performances nowadays are actually a conflation of those three or four anyway. They're not one of them in isolation. And then there's the alternate reading of the John, and that's the 1725 version. You can't argue on the basis of taste, of course, but for my taste, for what it's worth, both musically and religiously, I like the 1725 version better. But, you know, there's no question that the standard one is pretty magnificent, but yeah, there it is. So that's a very good question. Thank you.
Any other questions? You can raise your hand or write a question in the Q&A.
My goodness, did we silence this crowd?
There's another question from David Yee.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, yes. Okay. Thank you for your lecture, Dr. Marissen. A question about the 1949 performance that took place a year before Bach's death. I was wondering if you had any knowledge of whether Bach was healthy enough to conduct that performance himself or whether he had a substitute.
Well, that also is a very good question. He appears to have done that version of it. The last two Good Fridays that he was alive were performances of that so-called 1749 version of it. We don't know for sure whether he conducted it, and I suspect that he did, but there's no way really of knowing. Part of the reason that people wonder, of course, is because his health did decline pretty quickly towards the end of his life, on the one hand. And the other thing is that it was just discovered recently that, although the exact years aren't known, but it's presumed to be in 1742, 43 in there, towards the beginning of the decade, Bach appears to have turned over his conducting duties for the entire year to one of the most talented students who had graduated recently. So there's a student who's in his late 20s who was still in the Thomasschule, which is a very unusual thing in those days. And it was discovered a document in a small town in Germany. It was discovered a few years ago, in which that guy, when he was applying for a job somewhere, says, "You should hire me because I'm really good. I have lots of experience." Why I conducted the music in Leipzig for while Bach took a sabbatical, basically. Or he didn't put it in those words, but that's sort of what it came down to. And it's not everyone's quite sure what to make of that now. Some people think that Bach got fed up with church music and got fed up with religion and so on and so forth. And there's no way to prove such a thing. He may have been very tired, that's for sure, but I happen to know that it's overwhelmingly obvious, if you know a lot about the documentary evidence, that it's not that he gave up on religion, because it's from the 1740s that we have receipts from theological books that he bought at great expense in Leipzig at the trade fairs and so on. And his personal Bible is marked up quite heavily with marginalia that whose handwriting is can be identified as what his handwriting looked like in the 1740s. So I imagine that while he took his sabbatical from conducting every week, he was reading, you know, and studying things and composing other things like the musical offering, the Art of Fugue, and so on. So I guess sort of a roundabout, sort of bringing in a lot of things that you might not have been asking about, but the short answer is that we don't know for sure who conducted, but it was certainly all the way through Bach's career, it was his responsibility to see that it was covered. So if he couldn't do it, he had to find the other person to do it. He couldn't just say, I don't feel like doing it, and that's the end of story. He would have been fired for doing that.
A question from Warren Lyons. Can you provide additional books, articles on this subject, or perhaps any lectures on video?
On the subject of the John Passion in general, or is there some particular aspect of it?
I think the John Passion in general.
Yeah, I mean, there are a lot of books written about the John Passion from different perspectives and that focus on different things. It also depends, it really helps if you can read German, because Germans really love writing these books they call Konzertführer, which are sort of guides, concert guides to works. And there's a whole industry of writing books of that sort in every major, and plus they have much more music publishing going on in Germany than in most English speaking countries. So for any great piece like the John Passion or the Matthew Passion or the Mass in B minor, so on and so forth, there's probably going to be 3 or 4 or 5 books written about them. If your German is pretty good, the thing I can recommend the strongest, but it's a real commitment, there's a 3,200 page book by Martin Petzold from Leipzig. I think it's in 4 volumes, and it's called something like Bach Kommentar. And it's a commentary on all the vocal works of Bach, you know, one by one, going through the BWV catalog, including, you know, massive, like mini little books within the book on the John Passion and Matthew Passion. I hope it doesn't sound too immodest, but when I was much younger, I wrote a short book myself on the St. John Passion. It has the virtue of being in English and being very short. It's like it's about 100 pages, but about at least 60 pages of it, I think, are an annotated translation of the libretto. And then there's like a 40-page essay that's about the Lutheranism in the St. John Passion on the one hand, and the anti-Jewish polemic on the other hand, and to what extent they might be related to each other. Also in English, if you're really dedicated, my graduate school teacher, Eric Chafe, wrote a massive book for Oxford University Press called, I forget exactly what it's called, but it's like Bach and Johannine, something or other. And it is a very close study of both versions of the, particularly the 1725 version of the St. John Passion, and all the church cantatas of Bach that are based on texts from the Gospel of John. And pretty much everything you would ever want to learn, except for the polemic part, because some scholars genuinely don't believe there is any polemic, and others may well believe it, but are either too craven or whatever to actually admit it or discuss it. Most of what you would want to learn about the John, you could probably learn from the combination of reading my short book and Eric Chafe's very long book. I guess that's probably the best advice I could give.
A question from Ellen Cherry. Do you know of performances of the St. John Passion in Germany in the 1920s as Nazism was forming?
Yes, well, this is very interesting. There was a whole, what do they call it again? There was a whole sort of chamber within the Nazi hierarchy in which scholars were hired to change the texts of Bach and Handel works to make them more polemical, was the idea. And I don't know, I haven't studied, I know there is a whole book that I thought I had on my shelves here, and I was just looking for it the other day and I couldn't find it, so I guess I don't have it. But I know that about 15 years ago in Germany, there was a book of essays that was about, it's called something like Bach unter den Diktatoren, Bach under the dictators. And that's a sort of trope too in East Germany after the fall of the wall, to talk about negative aspects of Nazism and negative aspects of communism and sort of link them together, because one of the things they had in common was trying to, they were very uncomfortable with the sort of traditional Christianity of Bach's vocal works. I don't know, I can't remember specifically whether they did much to the John Passion. They were probably pretty happy with a lot of the way that it was in the first place. I do remember, though, because we were translating Ein Fest der Burg recently, Dan Malama and I. There's a magnificent church cantata on the hymn, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, by Bach, several different versions. And the close, one of the stanzas of Ein Fest der Burg is something like, Das Reich muss uns bleiben, the empire has to stay for us. And in Bach's day, Das Reich meant the kingdom of God. In German, you say the empire of God, not the kingdom of God, to refer to the establishment of God's rule in the cosmos and so on. And so what the Lutherans in Bach's day were simply saying was, may the kingdom of God come soon, and we want to be part of it. But the Nazis changed the text just slightly to make it very clear that it was the Third Reich that was to remain to the people singing Bach's church cantata number 80. And I was also disappointed and disturbed to discover a while back that the German newsreels, the Nazi newsreels in the late 30s and early 40s, used Bach's Ein Fest der Burg as their theme music for the announcing the news. So certainly the that is perfectly fair to bring that up, but the Nazis didn't find it very difficult to make use of Bach's music. But of course, Bach's music has tremendous prestige, so that's one of the first places they're going to want to go. But I don't know in more detail exactly how they adapted all of it, but I think it's all the thinking sort of behind it. Some of this was done with the music of Schütz as well, is they really liked the idea that it was German music, and that it was had Luther's text. Luther is a big hero for them too. And there's another aspect to all of this. But that would make a great research project for a courageous person who wants to write a dissertation on. But the problem was that that administration that I was talking about didn't get fully going. They lost the war by the time that if they had gone on for another more years, we would have had probably a full Bach and Handel repertory in additions with all the words changed and so on. But they were just getting warmed up as they lost the war. So that's about as much as I can say off the top of my head.
So a question and comment from David Tenney. First, he thanks you for this very stimulating talk. And could a change in performers or local politics have impacted Bach's decision on creating a different version of the work?
Oh, sure. I mean, because it's easy to forget that. I mean, Leipzig was a very sophisticated international trade city. It was a big deal for the general public. Sometimes has this idea that it was a kind of like second rung job to Bach. I mean, it's one of the most important music jobs in Europe in the 18th century. Very prestigious, and very well supported, and so on, for the most part, in Leipzig. And the town, it's very complicated politics in Leipzig, because the town council, which rotated, the entire council rotated every year, and so the mayor was a mayor, and so it's very complicated the way the Germans worked things out in those days. But they got to decide things like who got to be the music director for the churches for the city, and who got to be the teachers at the Thomasschule, because the Bach's job was to be his job was not director of music at the St. Thomas Church. That's what's often said. He was the director of music for the city of Leipzig and a teacher of music at the Thomasschule in Leipzig. And the Thomasschule, the Thomas School in Leipzig, supplied the instrumentalists and vocalists for all the main churches, the Thomas and the Nicholas and the Peter and Johann and so on and so forth. And so if the town councillors didn't like what was going on, they let people know. And it's not inconceivable that the combination of some of those town councillors, some of which were lawyers, some of which were theologians and so on and so forth, and the superintendent of the Leipzig churches and the philosophy and the theology professors at the University of Leipzig, they were all members of these main churches that Bach wrote his vocal music for. And if they didn't like the, Bach was responsible to make sure that what he did was theologically kosher, if I can use that word in this context. But if it wasn't, they would rain down hard on him. So my guess is that sometimes Bach was never did anything that they totally disapproved of, but they probably thought, you know, can you go a little bit more in this direction? And sometimes he did, and sometimes he didn't, and sometimes he fought with them about it, and sometimes he didn't. It was a ongoing thing the entire time that he was there. And certainly towards the end of his career, he got increasingly frustrated that he felt that he didn't really have the financial and moral support that he needed to put on really first-rate music, because it's not free, you know, it's an eternal problem in, I shouldn't say eternal, it's a forever problem in the history of church music, that there's a constant tension between, you know, what people want and what the music directors want to do and who gets to choose the hymns and so on and so forth. And all those things came up in Bach's career, in Bach's career as well. Maybe in connection with that, I should also say too, that a lot of folks don't realize, this is a very, very interesting aspect of Bach's job in Leipzig, was that in order to get it, he was required to, among other things, pass 2 3-hour long oral examinations given in Latin that tested him on his detailed knowledge of the Bible and of classical Lutheran theology. And the people before Bach and after him who took those exams, had university educations. Bach was one of the only people ever to have the position in Leipzig without a university degree. So he was reported to have passed these things with flying colors. He appears to have taught himself. He had a rather massive personal library of devotional and other religious books and Bible commentaries and so on. He seems to have really boned up on that and passed these exams. And when it came time for his successor, for example, and the exams for those things, for those church musician jobs, were administered by the theological faculty in Leipzig for all of Saxony. And at the end of Bach's life, there were several other people who were very good musicians, but they weren't able to get their job at the school or at the church because they couldn't pass this theological exam that Bach had done so well on. So it's common nowadays to sort of trivialize things. Always, Bach is an amazing person, but he's just this. Put it really crudely, he's an amazing musician, but he's kind of a dumb musician. You know, there's no such thing as a dumb musician in charge of the music for the city of Leipzig. It was a very sophisticated job, and Bach did it extremely well. But by the time 1749 and 1750 came around, it was another generation. As the Enlightenment really kicked in with its sort of optimism about human nature, and with its desire for simpler music and so on, Bach was very much at odds with the developing culture by the end, I would say.
John Pott asks if you'd like to comment on some of the more prominent recordings. He says, I think you are partial to Suzuki.
Yeah, there are many really great recordings of particularly the large scale works like the John and Matthew, because good orchestras and good choirs tend disproportionately to perform these works, because if you're doing a big concert on your concert series, it just seems much more practical all the way around to do a work like the John Passion or Matthew Passion of the Mass in B minor than to do 6 or 8 church cantatas, which would be wonderful too, but that usually doesn't happen. So yes, I my own taste runs very strongly towards how shall I put it? And there are sort of standard groups that have done many, many, there are like 4 or 5 groups that have done all or nearly all of the Bach vocal works. And of those, I would say, I don't mind saying publicly, people can quote me on this, that for example, Ton Koopman and the Amsterdam Baroque Orchestra and Chorus, very good on the sort of happy, sanguine, yes to life kind of vocal works, and pretty good on everything else. Then Philip Herrevega and his various Belgian and French choirs, extremely good on everything, basically, but really good at the dark, melancholic stuff. And then someone like Masaaki Suzuki and the Bach Collegium of Japan, sometimes they can be a little bit more straightforward, but on the whole, I would say they are extremely good on the yes to life happy stuff and also on the dark stuff, and basically really good at everything. So if you want to just get all the Bach vocal works, a pretty safe bet is to get the Suzuki and the Bach Lighting of Japan. You may want to supplement with some of these other groups. And then they're very exciting, for the most part, quite good performances too, I would say, by John Elliott Gardiner and the English, the Monteverdi Chorus and Orchestra. What he's especially good at are the most operatic and dramatic. If it's, if there's something that's really violent and over the top, he's definitely your man, but he's very good at everything else as well. The only caveat I would say is that his supposed complete recording of the Bach vocal works is it's a complete recording of the liturgical works, but there are a bunch of vocal works by Bach that weren't composed for the standard liturgy and the lectionary that goes with that. And so things for like the change of town council and things like that. There's like 25 extra cantatas by Bach that are not in Gardner's set. So get them all. Get them all, so I'd say you're never gonna regret it. But as my friend Jan Pott is probably was guessing, most of the recordings that I was playing just now, in fact, terrifying performance of the opening chorus of the John Passion was the most recent CD of the Bach Lighting of Japan, which was made on day one of the pandemic. It was the very day that the concerts were canceled and they were stuck in Europe and they had an empty hall, and the record company said, well, let's just make a CD of it then. And it's, you know, it's really very, very powerful.
One last question. Can you comment on CPE Bach's St. John Passions? Are they performable or are they too fragmentary?
Oh, no. What's the thing is in quite a number of passions by CPE Bach survive. And I like them. I mean, you know, but they're, I mean, it's not really fair to compare. There's no one ever set the Passion narrative in a way that comes close to being as powerful as the way that Bach set them. I think it's fair to say most reasonable people would agree with that assessment. But the CPE Bach Passions are certainly worth hearing. But what I find them a little harder to listen to in some ways, because the arias, the modern parts of them, are much more sort of Enlightenment oriented and are much sort of simpler, in a simpler style, and it's much more direct and sort of sanguine and upbeat, and I don't think they wear as well. I mean, it's fine to listen to once or twice, but you can't listen to them over and over and over again, I find, anyway. But the other intriguing thing about him is that, I'm not saying that C.P. Bach was lazy exactly, but quite a number of times in the biblical parts of his settings, the choruses, the choruses of Roman soldiers, or the choruses of the Jews, or the choruses of the combined Jews and Gentiles at Passover and so on. These are, he lifts them verbatim out of the Matthew and John Passion of Bach, of his father, and also of other composers from his father's generation, like Homelius and Telemann and so on and so forth, because they were scrambling to get them together, because in Hamburg, where he was, they did a lot of Passions every year on different days. And so he had a much more repertory to have to put together at that time of the church year than his father did. So I guess I would say in short, they're worth listening to, but I think very few people, unless you really, really are a CPE Bach fanatic, and I like him a lot, but if you really like him and don't particularly care for J.S. Bach, then maybe you might want to go there. But otherwise I would say that that's true of actually for a lot of the other Baroque Passions, Telemann too. Some of them are wonderful, but do I need to have, I have like, I think 25 of them on the shelves behind me here. And most of them I've listened to maybe once or twice, but the Bach you keep coming back to.
Well, that's the end of our questions. Thank you, Michael. It was a really wonderful lecture. And please join us next Sunday at 3 p.m. to hear the 1724 version of Bach, St. John Passion. Sorry, Michael. If only we'd known.
Well, thank you very much.
Anyway, so this will be posted probably by tomorrow on online, so that if you have friends who might want to watch it, they can do that. So thank you all. And thank you, Asaf Blasberg.
Thank you, Jane, so much.
Our wonderful technical host. Last week we had a lot more technical issues. This week was very smooth, so, but you never know what could happen. So, thank you.
Okay. Great. Thanks a lot. Okay.
All right. Bye.